one and done. It's a term that's usually applied to basketball players, but what if we use it to describe luxury as well? Items that are so timeless, so versatile, and yet so coveted, you'll only ever need to buy one and you're done.
In this episode, we cover six of our favorite product categories in travel and style and pick out the one and done for each. For the luxury traveler, we'll introduce the world's most versatile private jet, a future-proof vehicle, plus a pro-level camera for taking with you anytime, anywhere. For the stylish gentleman, we'll pick out the first and only suit you'll need to own, along with a perfect pair of footwear, and the ultimate go-anywhere, do-anything timepiece.
So join us, I'm David Celdran, and this is Executive Class. For those on a really tight budget, one and done makes a whole lot of sense, but that doesn't mean that even the wealthiest people can't benefit from it. Indeed, instead of owning an entire fleet of private jets, it's possible to just pick one that gets the job done.
For us, the one that does it all is the new Pilatus PC-24 business jet, the latest, greatest all-around aircraft from the Swiss company that created the ultimate versatile twin turboprop plane, the PC-12 NGX, which is a one and done of its own. The PC-12 is so versatile it's used for almost any aircraft role you can imagine, as a military plane or an air ambulance, for rescue missions or commercial operations, and yes, as a fly anywhere, do anything business shuttle as well. That's because of the several innovations introduced by Pilatus, like the ability to take off and land on short and unpaved runways. But even Pilatus has outdone itself with their newest model and first ever jet, the PC-24, our current favorite and obvious one and done pick. Executive Class was given the exclusive tour of the first PC-24 to land in Manila, and we were immediately impressed with this Swiss army knife of business jets. The PC-24 takes all the best innovations from their turboprop model, like the oversized side cargo door and short field performance, and combine these with the cabin size of a medium light jet and the performance and fuel economy of a light jet. Indeed, the PC-24's features are so unique for a business jet, Pilatus had to create an entirely new market category for it. SPV, for super versatile jet.
Well, pretty much it's the most versatile light business jet in the market. It's so simple because, example, you need to go to a resort island with a short, unprepared, unpaved, uncemented runway. The PC-24 can do it. If you need to go to a regular airport a little bit further away, its jet power is so strong it can get you there really quick, as fast as the airlines can.
ASEAN Aerospace, the Philippine distributor and service center of Pilatus aircraft, says demand worldwide for this jack-of-all-trades off-roader of a jet has been overwhelming, especially with those upgrading from the turboprop PC-12 model. Apart from the additional speed and power from jet propulsion, the new PC-24 also comes with much more luxurious, spacious, and customizable cabin interiors.
You can feel it's longer and it has a larger cargo door, a cargo room at the back. So there's like a dedicated room entirely for cargo.
And yet it only requires 100 meters more.
Yes.
So of takeoff distance. Yeah, amazing. Because it's a much bigger plane.
Yeah, so it's only 900 meters. So it can land in pretty much any airport in the country.
More runways, more space, more range, more possibilities. That's why it's called the world's first super versatile jet. A one and done with a set of features we'd love to have in a vehicle for overland travel. Like the PC-24, that vehicle would have to have power, safety features, cabin space and comfort, and above all, the ability to go pretty much anywhere, even off-road. For me, that's a luxury midsize SUV with all-wheel drive capability, just like the new Porsche Cayenne, which ticks all the important boxes and more as an all-around, everyday, high-performance SUV. But with internal combustion engines slowly being replaced by electric, it's time to consider an EV if you're looking for a future-proof SUV as well.
In an ideal world, we'd only ever need one car each. It's not just simpler and more practical, it also makes more economic and environmental sense. Indeed, especially if it's an electric vehicle. Could Lexus's new RZ be that one-and-done car? Let's find out.
The RZ 450e is the Japanese luxury brand's first all-EV in the country. And though Lexus is a little late to the fully electric game, the compact SUV sports all the features that make you want to embrace the latest generation of EVs. For one, it's fuel and carbon-free, so no crazy gas bills, no polluting the atmosphere. And while the country can improve its roadside charging infrastructure, with a full charge, new generation EVs like the RZ can run beyond 450 kilometers for worry-free out-of-town driving. Most EVs can also outperform conventional vehicles. The electric drivetrain provides seamless and smooth power when accelerating, with no lag between gears because EVs have no gears to begin with. And though all EVs share similar technology, not all are as luxurious or comfortable as the RZ.
So, what do I like about the RZ? Well, first of all, comfort. Levels of comfort are just insane. I'd give it a 10 out of 10. It's so quiet in the cabin. Not just because it's an EV, because some other EVs have this electric hum of sorts. This one's just absolute silence. And of course, the dreamy suspension. You just hardly feel anything on the road.
Especially on uneven and slippery provincial roads. True one-and-done needs to get you through almost anything.
It's got two motors, one for each axle, all-wheel drive, which is great for forging little streams like this after a strong thunderstorm. The roads are slippery, the roads are muddy, not a problem.
A taller ride height allows you to see the road better than other all-electric crossovers would. Higher ground clearance is useful in unpredictable terrain like this. Although the RZ falls under the compact SUV category, it feels more like a mid-size SUV within.
It's actually much bigger inside than it looks from the outside. If you're looking for a one-and-done car, it's got to be something big enough, but not too huge that makes it hard to park and hard to get through, you know, narrow country roads like this.
After taking the RZ cross-country, I'd say it can qualify as a go-anywhere, do-anything EV. Though for longer distance out-of-town travel, I'd like it to have much more than a maximum range of 470 kilometers on a full charge, and a flat cargo space for luggage once the engineers figure out a better way to store the spare. After all, as even with a Pilatus jet, product designers and engineers will always have to compromise features to achieve maximum versatility, just as we'll see with one of the most sought-after cameras on the market today.
Okay, not everyone can survive with just one car in the garage, especially if you have a family to take care of. However, if you're like those with too many cameras already, you might want to just pick one. One that's small, light, but capable enough so that you can carry it everywhere you go, so that you never miss that decisive moment. A camera like the Leica Q3.
The Q3 from the historic German camera manufacturer is Leica's latest and highest resolution version of the uber-popular Q series of full-frame digital cameras with a fixed 28mm lens. Frankly, the previous Q2 model I took to Sapa in Vietnam some years ago was already as versatile, compact, or as one-and-done as it gets for a travel camera, equipped with a high-res 40-megapixel sensor and a fast, wide-angle lens that was great for landscapes and portraits. There was hardly any situation I encountered that required more than the weather-sealed Q2 offered. So I wonder if the Q3 is even necessary.
So which one is the Q2 and which is the Q3? It's hard to tell, right? Because just from the looks of it, they're almost identical. And that's because they're pretty much identical. Same body except for a few changes. Of course, exactly the same lens. In other words, Leica took the best of the Q2 and kept it in the Q3, but with some very important improvements. Let's get into that. The first and most, I would say, important improvement, most critical improvement, is the sensor, 60 MP from the previous 40 plus megapixels. And it does make a big difference.
For one, far more detail if ever you need to enlarge the image, and far better dynamic range. In high contrast situations, you'll get even more information in the shadows and highlights of the image, even without processing in post. It's unbelievable.
Okay, let's try this very high contrast scene and see how great the dynamic range of the Q3 actually is with its new sensor. Now here's another improvement I really like. It's the ability to crop beyond 75 millimeters, which is where it ended with the Q2, and go to 90 millimeters. Allows you to do close-ups without having to actually go close up.
Because of the 60 megapixel sensor, you can now crop the image even closer without sacrificing sharpness or detail. The new sensor also improves autofocus performance for capturing fast-moving subjects and photography in low-light situations. The higher ISO, now up to 100,000, also improves capturing images in the dark.
Another improvement is the tilt screen. Just when I thought Leica was going to ignore what users were saying about the need for a tilt screen, they did bring it in and introduce it in the Q3. Who cares what the purists say? A tilt screen is extremely practical.
Sure, other cameras have the same, but it must have been a big debate between Leica's designers and engineers to break with tradition. But at least they kept the lens. For most, the single most important reason to buy a Leica even. Sumilux 28mm aspherical lens with maximum 1.7 aperture is for me the best thing about this camera. The bokeh is creamy and the out-of-focus areas of the image are dramatic. It's also extremely sharp from edge to edge, the perfect match for the 60 megapixel sensor, more so with its optical image stabilization engaged.
I've always loved the Sumilux lens of the Q2, and it's the same lens on the Q3 as I said. And one of those wonderful features is the macro function. You can really go up this close. It's an optical macro function, not a digital one, so it's more natural. Wow, it gets really close. So another improvement from the Q2 is that the Q3 now has 8K video, much higher video resolution. And because it's got a 28mm lens, 8K allows you to crop even closer to get some details, let's just say, from this pool over here.
Without a headphone jack to monitor the microphone input, the Leica Q3 isn't exactly a professional video camera. But for filming footage alone, at 8K or even 4K 10-bit, this is better than most I've worked with. A compact, robustly built, weatherproof full-frame camera with an optically superior and fast wide-angle lens with macro function and in-camera cropping, plus 8K video recording and Leica's legendary color science. It's the only camera you'll want to bring on your next trip, or even as an everyday carry. Welcome back to Executive Class. Our list of one-and-done products continues with the most versatile investment pieces.
The principle of one and done can also apply to the clothes and accessories you wear, such as a suit, for example, which should be versatile enough to wear in any kind of weather and at any time of day.
For a one and done suit, it ought to be a jacket with matching trousers in a color, fabric, and style that can be worn anytime and anywhere the attire will be appropriate. Though we can walk into most menswear shops to pick one off the rack, we recommend a bespoke suit by a tailor with experience, skill, and access to the highest quality suiting materials. A tailoring shop like Tino in Legazpi Village, Makati.
Why bespoke and why not just off the rack?
First, a bespoke suit guarantees a perfect fit to your body. So the master tailor is very much involved in the process. So he makes sure that all the measurements are correct, how the suit falls on your body are correct, and you don't look awkward.
Unless you belong to the 0.1% of the male population with a perfectly proportioned body, ready-to-wear suits, even expensive ones, will always need to be altered to fit. Though in my experience, never as well as a handcrafted full canvas custom-made suit would.
That's one reason why, if you're gonna spend on just one suit and on one big time on one suit,
yes,
make it a bespoke suit, right?
True.
Okay. Second is okay. So let's start with what kind of suit should it be?
So you want a safe suit that you could use for a wedding, for formal occasions, for casual occasions, for business meetings.
So and that won't go out of style.
Yeah.
5 years from now.
Yeah.
Basically, 10 years from now, even if not forever.
Yeah.
Because there are suits that last forever.
Yeah. With this one, I would recommend the classic colors for the suit. It just plays around navy, shades of gray like charcoal, or brown or dark brown. The good thing about, take for example, a navy suit. So if you're in a morning setting, you're in a business setting, It looks very corporate. It looks very a business suit. And then if you have an event in the evening, so the lighting is different, it's a bit dimmer, it's a bit yellow, it looks like a dark suit, so it looks like a formal suit. And also you have to consider the quality of the fabric. So if you're going to wear it from morning to evening, I'd recommend a full-bodied fabric. Full-bodied fabric means it has the correct weight, but it's also open weave so that it fits our weather. Mm-hmm. So it's more breathable as compared to the closely weaved fabric. So with this one, I have something on top of my mind. This one is from Holland & Sherry Crispair.
Indeed, get the best fabric you can afford. A one-and-done suit needs to withstand constant wear and tear. It also needs to feel natural and comfortable in various types of weather and to resist wrinkling as much as possible. And yet, it should also have character. This high-quality wool I picked has a subtle texture that's interesting when seen up close. And just because it's a blue suit, it doesn't have to be plain. Since it's bespoke, you can customize your suit further with lining in a wide variety of patterns and colors. You also get to choose your type of buttons and the overall style and silhouette. But be careful not to go overboard. A one-and-done needs to be versatile and classic, not a trendy fashion piece, so try to stick to the basics, like a two-button single-breasted jacket with notched lapels in a classic width, jetted pockets with flaps, and double vents at the back. Shoulders shouldn't be too soft or overly structured and padded, but should just look natural.
And trousers, what about trousers? Because we always forget about the trousers.
Yeah.
Does that really matter, or you just leave it up to the tailor?
Well, for the trousers, it really depends on your preference. So with us, we have a bias on high-waisted trousers, right? Because it makes you look taller.
Keep to a classic length and a classic cut, however, though you can still individualize with cuffs and pleats and a waistband instead of belt loops. As you can tell by now, ordering a bespoke suit involves so many decisions, and that's why it's best to listen and learn from a master tailor like Nap Arienza, with almost 50 years of experience, including a stint with Brioni in Italy. After initial measurements are taken, a first fitting is required for further tweaking, and another one weeks after.
Unfortunately, a one-and-done bespoke suit only applies to the actual suit itself because you'll need more than just one fitting before you're finally done. In fact, ideally, about three fittings. And this is only my second one.
Ideally, 2 to 3 months is what's required, but the bespoke process only ends when the client is satisfied with a final fit and finishing before the one-and-done suit is ready. It's the same process for a bespoke pair of shoes. The meticulous measurements, the long list of choices, and the various stages of fittings before the pair is delivered. But for those happy with their experience with ready-to-wear, there's one pair that best fits the description of a one-and-done footwear. And we found it at the newly opened Gucci boutique in Greenbelt 4, Makati.
It's not unusual, even for men, to have a closet full of shoes, some more practical than others. But if you were to take just one pair alone with you, everywhere you go, what would it be? Well, for me, it would be something like this. It's Gucci's classic horsebit loafer. It's a 70-year-old design, and it hasn't really changed at all over those years. In fact, it's so timeless, I'm wearing a similar one, which I bought more than a decade ago. It still looks good on me.
The Gucci horsebit loafer is celebrating its 70th anniversary as a brand's icon for a reason. No other pair is as instantly recognizable, as desirable, and above all, as versatile as these slip-ons designed by Aldo Gucci in 1953. Gucci's loafers have been worn by world leaders and rap artists alike. They can be worn with tailored suits and tuxedos, just as effortlessly with casual weekend clothes, even sockless with shorts. Although loafers aren't a Gucci invention, the idea of adding the equine-inspired metal snaffle bit is Aldo's brainchild, a detail that has elevated the casual loafer to fashionable footwear.
These horsebit loafers are so versatile, and so are loafers in general. So versatile, they match with any outfit you can think of. But if you find black too boring, it comes in different colors as well.
Even in a light shade of brown or an emerald green, they still come across as classic. Loafers, which are closely patterned after slippers, are also easier to take on and off, and far more comfortable than derbies and oxfords with laces, making them a practical yet elegant one-and-done pair indeed.
As you've seen, the concept of one-and-done can apply to other luxury categories, and that includes wristwatches, although watch enthusiasts don't actually call it that. They have a different term for it. They call it GADA, G-A-D-A, or go anywhere, do anything. Basically, a watch that can handle any situation you can think of.
Picking a GADA often comes down to the brand you prefer most and choosing a model that best fits your budget and idea of a watch for all occasions and situations. Rolex aficionados will no doubt point to the Explorer as the one watch that does it all, while Patek Philippe fans will probably pick the stainless steel Nautilus for its versatility. GADA watches aren't the same as Grail watches, so they don't have to be rare or too expensive. So a Tissot PRX Powermatic can be one. So too a Grand Seiko SBGH 273. As for our top GADA pick, it's the Omega Aquaterra 150-meter master chronometer in a 38mm stainless steel case and bracelet. Either with a blue dial or a silver one qualifies. As you can tell, regardless of the price point and brand, they all share common characteristics like the size, build quality, design, and reliability.
So what exactly qualifies as a GADA or a one-and-done wristwatch? Well, I've listed about 10 criteria that make up that perfect wristwatch. It starts with versatility, a watch that's both dressy and sporty at the same time.
The Omega Seamaster Aquaterra will fit into any social occasion, from black tie dinners to weekend yacht parties to, well, every event and outfit you match it with. Although it's a legitimate sports watch, the Aquaterra's design is streamlined enough to pass for a dress watch, especially with a leather strap. No chronometer pusher sticking out, and no dive bezels and colorful dials to attract attention either. Just a useful date function and a distinctive arrow minute hand and teak deck surface to lend unique character.
Next is the size and the profile of the watch. I call it the cuff test, meaning it should be slim enough to fit under your shirt cuff.
This is where most watches over 40 millimeters fail, unless you never button your shirt cuffs or have your shirt tailored to fit a larger case. The Omega's 38mm size and slim for a sports watch profile slips smoothly under a standard shirt cuff, and even when unbuttoned, the case size sits perfectly balanced and well-proportioned on most wrists.
And since we're calling it a GADA watch, it's a watch that should go anywhere and do anything, and therefore, it needs to be robust and really well-built. And that's where features like water resistance comes in.
Well, it's called Seamaster and Aquaterra for a reason. The watch is water resistant to a depth of 150 meters. You can swim, snorkel, and get soaked in a storm with it. The sapphire crystal glass, anti-magnetic feature, and stainless steel case allow it to withstand all weather and all terrain conditions too. Agata needs to be reliable as well, or why even bother taking it everywhere? The Omega's robust caliber 8800 with coaxial escapement is a certified master chronometer approved by METAS, so it's tested to be accurate within 5 seconds per day.
Another feature you must think about is serviceability. Can parts be sourced? Can the watch be serviced?
Certainly, there are other watches that come close, maybe even surpass the Aquaterra. But just be sure you won't have to have it sent to another country for servicing, or wait years to have it repaired. The Caliber 8800 is a workhorse of Omega, so it has parts aplenty.
And finally, it's a watch you intend to wear every day, and not just hide in a vault somewhere. After all, it's your only watch.
Indeed, a one-and-done reminds us that it's often better to have a few good pieces, or even just a single good one, rather than maintaining, servicing, and, well, worrying about a huge and underutilized fleet, garage, collection, or wardrobe of stuff. If you haven't discovered that yet, you can try it right now.
And that's all for this episode of Executive Class. I'm David Celdran. Thanks for watching.